I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight on Insight, who's getting ripped off at work? You got an order for $12,000 in underpaid wages. Have you seen any of that money yet?
No.
I was paid by $8 an hour, and then for my second job, I was paid by $12 an hour.
What were you paid for your work at this place?
I wasn't.
At all?
This is effectively slavery. She's not getting paid at all. She can't go anywhere. She can't leave.
Welcome everyone, good to have you here tonight. Selena, you came to Australia from Germany in late 2014 to work as an au pair. You were 18 years old. You'd set up the job before you arrived here. What did you expect?
So I expected being like living with a family, getting the way to see the culture from Australia, seeing how the kids grew up.
How did you find the family? How did you work out who you're going to work for?
So I was with an agency in Germany.
Did you know anyone in Australia when you came here?
No, I didn't know anybody.
And why did you choose this particular family? It was a single parent family with three kids.
I was feeling to see the way how the single mum raised up her child because her kids, because I'm raised by a single mum. Yeah, so the mum ended up being drunk pretty much every night. At one point, she ignored me. She didn't talk to me. Yeah, like a few things. I had to pay for my food. She took the car away. So I wasn't feeling...
What had you been promised? What were you told the arrangement would be?
Yeah, so the arrangement was she pays me every week $250. I get a car with petrol. She pays for my food. But I ended up paying mostly for myself or haven't earned money at all.
So what were you paid?
So normally I got paid between 180 or under, and then 1 week I got only $150.
And she provided accommodation and food?
Yeah, so she provided me accommodation, but I had to pay for my food most of the times.
What was expected of you for that money that you were getting?
So I was supposed to work 35 hours around.
And what were you expected to do during that time?
So I had to take mostly the little boy out to like cinemas or playgrounds, but I had to do lighthouse work as well, so cleaning, laundry, vacuum and kind of stuff.
What would be the longest days hours that you worked?
12 hours.
And how often would that happen?
Mostly twice a week, sometimes three, depends how she was feeling.
So did you have any idea from the hours you worked how much money you'd get?
When I applied to be for this family, we got a letter saying you work around these hours and the mum pays you that money. But, yeah, never got the money.
So how much were you promised for the hours?
For 35 hours, around $250.
And who was the letter from?
The agency who I came with.
Did you get sick during that time?
Yeah, so I got sick really badly. And then I called her saying I was sick, can I please drop off the kids to the dad? And she said no. And she was angry at me because, yeah, I was, like, so sick, I couldn't do anything.
Ju Cheong, you're an expert in labour law. What sort of protection is there for an 18-year-old who, au pair like Selena, who comes to Australia for work and it doesn't turn out to be what was promised? Does it have a legal arrangement?
What you have is sort of a somewhat feudal belief that the wages and working conditions of these workers, including Celine, are the discretion of the employer. And in most cases, this is wrong. It's wrong morally, this is wrong legally. In most cases, people in Celine's positions will be employees at law. They'll be entitled under the Fair Work Act to the minimum wage.
That's if she's regarded as an employee, though. And it's not altogether clear with jobs like au pairs whether they are regarded as employees, is it? I mean, it's a grey area in terms of, you know, being covered by an award or it being very straightforward. I mean, there are informal arrangements like this, I think, all over the country all the time.
I think first we can understand what we understand by informal. I mean, what we have in the case of Celine was the arrangement was initiated by a letter. This was organised by recruitment agencies who were operating as part of the industry. And one would infer from all that that really a contract was reached in that position. And if a contract was reached in a position where her work was under close supervision by her employer, with her working considerable hours, I think it all points to an employment relationship.
Mm. Yeah.
The key to establishing an employment relationship is the control you exercise over the other person. And clearly, in this, even it's informal only because the setting is informal. It's in someone's home, and there's the informality of being in a family. But ultimately, the woman that she was working for exercised control, complete control, even more control than a normal employer would, because she dictated where she'd sleep, what she would eat. So that degree of control clearly shows an employment relationship.
What about the idea that you've been promised something and delivered something else? I mean, can you do anything about that?
Well, you can. I mean, it's against the law to engage in misleading or deceptive conduct. So within the law, there is specific protection about that.
So how many cases have there been where au pairs have successfully managed to get either compensation for situations or nannies have in a similar position? How many cases have we got in Australia where they've actually had some kind of payment made or...?
I've read thousands and thousands of employment law cases because that's what I've done. I've represented thousands of people, but I can't say I've ever actually read or seen a successful prosecution in a circumstance like that.
In relation to an au pair or
that's
a nanny.
Right. Mm.
Ju Cheong, have you?
I haven't either.
Natalie, you also came to Australia. In your case, as a backpacker a couple of years ago. You had a good au pair experience.
Yeah.
Then to qualify for the second year of your visa, you had to do farm work. How did you find farm work here?
I think for a lot of backpackers, we just, within our community, it's Gumtree, it's Facebook, it's the free social media sites.
So what did you find?
So I went onto Gumtree and I'm a little bit fussy with ads, like I always wanted to make sure that I was safe. I went onto Gumtree, I found a guy that was advertising a role on a sheep farm. He said he had other backpackers. It was on Kangaroo Island. He had his company name up and everything, a profile with a picture, so it wasn't anything to be weary of. And I contacted him directly. Checked him out on Facebook, checked out the comments, Googled him, Googled the company, ABN number, everything.
So it all looked okay?
Yeah, it all looked fine.
What happened when you got there?
So I flew over from Adelaide and I was picked up quite late at night by him. He was actually drunk when he picked me up. We were swerving all the way home, and at that point I was quite scared of him, but I thought, you know, maybe he's, I don't know, just a little bit tipsy, but we'll get there.
This is Kangaroo Island.
Yeah, they don't have public transport or anything on the island. And as you're driving around, it's just very dark because it's so derelict. There is nothing there.
And he told you he had a wife and that there were other people working there?
Yeah, he told me he had other people working there, that he had a partner.
And what was there when you got there?
No one. No one at all. I walked into the house and at that point I kind of thought, okay, so there's nobody here. And then that was another alarm bell from the fact that I got in the car with a drunk man and now I'm with nobody.
What happened after that?
So the next day he was quite abusive to me, like in the way he spoke to me. He was just very rude. It was almost like he wanted to make me scared. So it was like he made me do things that a normal person wouldn't do.
Like?
Like, he was into animal, like, slaughtering. And so when he asked me and said, would you ever slaughter an animal? I said no. But yet he would do it in front of me to try and scare me. So he'd kill lambs or animals in front of me and then, like, throw them off into piles and say, this is where they go and this is what happens when this annoys me or whatever. He was a very angry person. So he kind
and
of...
And what were you thinking during this just time?
At this point, I thought, I have no contact with the outside world because there's no signal on my phone because I don't have a Telstra network. I'm on Vodafone. And he tells me there's no Wi-Fi. So I'm here, no one around me, no contact with anybody, thinking I need to just be smart, not open my mouth and just wait and see what happens, because if I do something that puts my life in danger, then I'm screwed.
So you were really frightened?
I was so frightened.
And he had his mates around
as
well?
Yeah, so there's obviously on this island, it's a workers' island, and there's a lot of men on there. And there was just an occasion of one night where I was at home and I was asleep and half asleep, and I heard all these cars coming down the drive. And you think, well, who's that? Because there's no one that lives near us. Like, the furthest house was 13 km. Like, who is here at 2 o'clock in the morning? And then like 8 or 9 guys from the football turned up, all drunk, completely drunk. And I'm there on my own, lock myself in the room because I just feel so scared that I'm alone and I still don't know how to get out of this situation. And all these people have just turned up and they're all male. Like, it's so threatening.
And what were they like? How did they behave?
They were rude. I could hear what they were saying outside about some girls that I know were taken off the farm previously and about myself. They were just vile, and they were smashing on the window and smashing on the door and then calling my name, telling me to come out. And I just thought, no, just stay here, don't move, just don't move. So I didn't.
What were you paid for your work at this place?
I wasn't.
At all.
And I didn't even, in the 2 weeks that I lasted, I didn't even get that signed off towards my 88 days for
your visa to do the farm work. Mm-hmm. How long did you last there?
15 days.
Why didn't you leave earlier?
Because I was trying to work out how I could. So I used to leave the house to see how far I was from the town, so I'd go for a walk. But obviously when I go for a walk, he wants to know why I'm going for a walk, because who are you going to see? There's no one here. And so I'd have to go and work out if I could run it, if I could do it in the dark. I can't, there's no lights. So I had to think about all these things, you know, and I had to make sure I did it in a proper way.
How much were you told you'd be paid?
He said to me it was going to be $350 a week with my board and my, you know, my lodgings, my food.
What did he say when you asked for money?
He just said, you're just going to have to wait. He was just too aggressive for me. I couldn't push him any further. I just had to go with it.
How did you get out?
I luckily, unbeknown to him, I have 10 years experience in IT, so I hacked into his modem that he had in the office when he told me he didn't have one. He went out one day shopping and I pretended to be sick, and I went in there and I plugged in the modem, WhatsApped through to my au pair family in Sydney, and got her to do everything for me because I still had no phone connection, so I couldn't still make calls. I couldn't call the police or anything, so I made her do it for me.
So she called the police?
So Charlotte called the police, yeah.
And what happened when the police came?
Well, the police, when she rang, they already knew where I was and who I was with, which was quite scary, the fact that they already knew without her even saying. And they were like, we're going to go straight away. It'll take us an hour and a half to get there, so tell her just to wait. And I was too scared, like, if he went crazy in the hour and a half that I was waiting for them to come.
And what happened when the police arrived? Were there any charges laid as a result of this?
Well, no, because the thing is, and what happened with previous girls that were there, there's no proof of what... I mean, it's mental trauma. What he's doing is mental abuse. He's not actually touching anybody. He's not hurting anybody. And there had to be something that happened that was really bad for them to say to me, oh, you can press charges.
You reported your case to the Department of Immigration?
Yeah.
What happened there?
They told me that if I wanted to stay in Australia for my second year, I would still need to do the full 88 days on another farm.
So it didn't even count?
Didn't count. Mm.
Did you think about trying to retrieve the money for the unpaid work?
No, I just thought, I just wanted to get away. I didn't even care. I just wanted to leave.
Mm. Anyone want to comment on this?
I mean, I think that what this exposes is some of the gaps in the legal system, because... she could have commenced action for that, well, it would have been about $700 that she was owed, but very quickly any of the court costs, or if she had a lawyer, legal costs would have swamped her, completely outweighed what she was trying to seek. And she could have gone to the Fair Work Commission to get an order that bullying stopped, because that's effectively what was happening. But by that stage, she'd already called the police because it was so serious and got out. This is effectively slavery. She's not getting paid at all. She can't go anywhere. She can't leave until she has to break into someone's modem and get help from the police.
Sana, you came here as a skilled migrant from Pakistan with your family 3 years ago. You worked on site at Zarela, a carrot producer in South Australia that supplies Woolworths, and you were employed through a labour hire company called Hoy Brothers Recruitment,
yep.
Proprietary Limited,
yep.
which in turn supplied the labour to Zarella.
Zarella, yeah.
Yep. How many hours a week were you working?
There were a few days that they weren't busy, and that was maximum 10, but throughout the year we were working 12 hours, 6 days a week.
12-hour shifts, six days a week.
Yep.
And what did you get paid for that work?
They were just paying me a flat rate of $17.
$17 an hour?
Yep.
Okay, so no overtime, no penalty rates?
No overtime, no penalty rates, no night shift and all, anything like that.
For working the 12 hours?
Yep.
Okay. How does that compare to what you should have been paid?
That I found very late, because a lot of people working there, they don't know about their rights. It's like there is a minimum wage rate. And when I found that, I was thinking that I should go for the claim to FWO.
And to the Fair Work.
Yeah. And then I did that after I left that position, because when I was working there at that time, I couldn't. I was wondering if I do that, they will just fire me.
So you were too scared to raise
because it was hard to find work there, and I've been through a lot of that odd job, so I didn't want to lose that job.
How long were you there?
I was there for 12 months.
You took your case to the Fair Work Ombudsman, and you got an order for $12,000 in underpaid wages. Have you seen any of that money yet?
No, because the last time I had a conversation with the Fair Work, they told me that the company has been in liquidation now.
This is the labour hire company hired you.
Yep.
Do you think you will see any of that money?
My hopes are very low.
I should point out that we contacted Zarella, the carrot producer that you were working for, and they said as soon as those labour hire problems were brought to their attention in July 2015, they stopped using labour hire companies and they now directly employ their workers. Sarah, you're with the National Farmers Federation. Plenty of farmers use labour hire companies. What's your reaction to Sana's experience?
Look, we have had issues with the labour hire component of our workforce, because in the agriculture sector it's actually very hard to find workers, and so we look anywhere for them, including, you know, next door, overseas, and increasingly from the migrant workforce. And sometimes we have really good experiences, but sometimes we don't.
But how widespread is underpayment in the labour hire industry?
Look, I don't think it's across the board. I certainly acknowledge that it's out there, but there are some very good labour hire companies working specifically in the agriculture sector, working very hard to make sure that they do the right thing. Casuals don't get overtime and penalty rates in the horticulture industry. That reflects the nature of the industry. So even though it might not seem fair, that is the rule.
But, you know, we have a situation here where the Fair Work Ombudsman has said $12,000 is owed to this person. So clearly something was really wrong.
Rates of pay, I think. In this case, it sounds like he was underpaid about $4 or $5 an hour.
Mm. That's sad, Jenny. I mean, the Fair Work Ombudsman actually has an industry campaign looking at a series of industries that have high levels of non-compliance. And one of those industries is actually the agricultural industry. And I think the broader point you made here is that what we're seeing here are not isolated examples. There are examples that illustrate broader problems that are concentrated in particular hazardous industries, including agriculture, including hospitality, cleaning, domestic work, taxi driving, we can add, and so on and so forth.
Why is it happening? I mean, why do you think it's happening, Sarah? Why are people being underpaid like that?
What we tend to find, actually, is that often this is a case of where co-ethnic exploitation comes into play. Many of these labour hire companies are run by people who came to Australia themselves as migrants, became established and have a network overseas of people who are interested in earning Australian income, which makes sense. And because they operate, in a way that they've sort of set up themselves, they don't tend to necessarily show enough respect for the law.
Sana, I'm interested that you came here on a skilled migration visa as an engineer. Yep. Your first job was in a car wash.
Yep.
So how much were you paid there?
There I was paid $14 an hour.
But on paper, you were paid a different rate to the $14.
Yeah, that's the trick they were doing. If you ask for the pay slip, they had to write on it 21 or 23 an hour and then reduce the amount of hours you worked. When in fact, you have worked more hours on that $14 an hour rate.
It's called the half pay scam. In the 7-Eleven case that we're running, and Pranay was one of the victims of it, that was systemic across the franchises. They would be given a pay slip that said, so you've worked 20 hours at $24 an hour, which is the lawful rate, but in actual fact, they would have worked 40 hours for $12 an hour, and so we're just consistently grossly underpaid. The scam's changed now. It's no longer the half pay scam on the pay slip. What happens is they get the full pay, and then the employees get taken out to an ATM and are asked to withdraw the cash, half the cash, and give it back to the employer.
What were you paid for that 3 years of work?
Nothing. I had no pay, no money.
At all?
Pay me at all, no.
Why did you stay for 3 years?
I had no idea. Where to go, who will give me help. I had no passport, I had no money, I didn't know anyone.
Sunny, you're an international student from China. You say you were underpaid working at two different Asian food outlets a couple of years ago. What sort of hourly rate were you being paid in those jobs?
The first one was a Chinese takeaway restaurant in suburb Melbourne. I was paid by $8 an hour for the trial period, which lasted for about a week and a half. And then the pay got raised to $10 an hour. And then for my second job, it was at a shopping centre food court. I was paid by $12 an hour. I was promised at the start that it would get raised to 15 and then eventually 18, but I never got the pay raise.
Did you know you were being underpaid?
Yes. I was told by some of my Chinese and other international friends that it is really common among international students from a non-English speaking background to get underpaid.
Did your friends who said to expect to be paid lower rates, did they mean lower rates than Australian students would get paid?
Yes.
And is that what you saw? Was that the case? Did you ever...
Yes. I would say 80% of my friends, my international student friends, are all getting underpaid.
And who is employing the international students?
Mostly for Chinese students, they are Chinese employers because many of the Chinese students, they don't speak good English and they prefer working in a Chinese restaurant or retail. And for others, I would say they were like Indian restaurants as well and Thai, Malaysian, all kinds of hospitality and retail places.
How did you find the job you had at the Chinese restaurant?
I saw the job advertisement on a Chinese website. It's like Gumtree in Australia, but it's in Chinese. It's targeted to Chinese population in Australia.
What's it called?
It's called EE.com.
Now, we had a look at the website and we plucked a random ad for a job as a delivery driver. For a company from that website. The employer was a Thai takeaway in Melbourne. And on the ad, we've got it here, it says the hourly rate is $15 or less. You must have completed high school. It says the salary is $13 an hour, a bit lower down in the ad, which doesn't quite add up with the earlier one, but never mind. And that customers always give tips and normally the boss will give those tips to the driver. Now, Ju Cheong, $13 an hour, would that be acceptable?
That's most likely be under the minimum. Depending on the age of the worker, they'll be under the minimum wage for that particular worker.
Is that legal to do that? Or can it be prosecuted if somebody's advertising something under the minimum wage?
In terms of the ad you just showed, I would say that actually is perfectly legal. And in fact, highlights quite a gap in the law. It would be illegal for them to actually employ the worker under the minimum wage, but to advertise rates under the minimum wage is not necessarily illegal.
So it's the employing that's illegal?
Correct.
It's not the advertising?
Correct, yeah. I think part of the broader discussion too, Jenny, is really to be one that highlights the fact that we as a community actually benefit in many ways from exploited labour, whether it be through cheap agricultural products, whether it be through cheaper restaurant food and so on. And I think that's part of the conversation we need to be having about whether, you know, how do we respond as consumers? Have we been acclimatised to these cheaper goods that are built on the backs of exploited labour?
Mm-hmm. Amy, you came to Australia from Taipei 3 years ago, first on a student visa, then on a working holiday visa. How did you find a job?
I just find a job like other backpacks from the Facebook. That's it.
Okay, so you were taken on by a labour hire company, AWX, to work in the meat industry.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And did you start in a paid job straight away?
No, actually the AWX, they access to have the training course for 1 month, and we need to pay $300 for training course, but didn't get anything. Just free work for 1 month. We work about 10 hours per day, but get nothing.
You didn't get paid at all for that work?
No.
And that was regarded as the training?
Yeah.
Giri, you're an employment lawyer. What's the legal position around a situation like this, well, training?
It's illegal, what you went through. Just because you're going through training doesn't mean you don't get paid. In addition, making her pay would be, I think you could probably characterise that as an unlawful deduction of money from her.
Mm-hmm. When did they start paying you, Amy?
They just start paying us from when we start work in the Tiswagawaga, as $17 per hour.
What sort of hours were you working?
We start 6 o'clock and finish 4:30 every day, but sometimes you need to work extra hour because they ask you to work overwork. Mm-hmm. And you can't say no. If you say no, you're going to lose your job directly. That's it.
Now, we contacted AWX to comment on your case. They didn't reply, but last year they did say, through their lawyers, they were aware of the training program that was set up without authorization by a former employee, and they were taking steps to address that. So I should put that out there. And they've also said that their employment practices comply with contemporary corporate social and ethical standards, and that they treat their workers fairly and ethically. So that's the comment we got, you know, by looking at those documents back at what the company said last year. Grant, your union's taken up Amy's case. It went through the Fair Work Commission, but it's unresolved. Why?
Yeah, generally, we took the matter to Fair Work, to the Commission, and we made a decision that the Commission simply cannot deliver an outcome for Amy. So what we did was withdraw the application, and we've submitted an application to the Federal Circuits Court. So we thought it is much better for us to take it to a jurisdiction that can deliver an order, and we can also pursue penalties on behalf of Amy.
Mm. How much do you think she's owed, Amy's owed?
The estimate that we have at the moment is about $5,000.
And the company is disputing that?
Yes, they have.
I should point out that we did invite the Fair Work Ombudsman on to the program tonight, but unfortunately she was unavailable, so just so everyone knows that. Earlier today, I spoke with another migrant worker called Sandra, who didn't want to join our forum tonight, but she still wanted to share her story. Sandra, you came to Australia from Fiji. Why?
I came to Australia to work with one of the family that I knew back from my country. They offered me a job.
So this was an Australian family that you met in Fiji?
They were Australian citizens, but they were in Fiji for 4 years.
Now, you took on a job as a housekeeper. It was a family of four. What did they promise you when you came to Australia?
They promised me to come to Australia to work with them, so I'll be paid, and later I can get my permanent residence, and they could help me to bring my family.
So did they pay for your flight and visas and organise all of that sort of thing?
Yes, they did. They did help me.
How much did they promise that they would pay you when you got here?
They didn't promise me how much money they're going to pay, but they told me it'll be paid.
And what visa were you brought in on?
I was brought in the tourist visa. After 2 weeks, they got my passport, and they told me it's they're going to help me for my permanent residence, and immigration needs my passport. So I just handed it to them.
And how long did they have your passport for?
For 3 years.
What work did you do for them during that 3 years?
I was doing all the housework, like gardening, cooking, looking after the two dogs, cleaning the swimming pool, and even massage the lady of the house.
Massage as well?
Yes, I did.
So how many hours a day would you have been working?
That's a good question. I was awake 7 o'clock and I ended up till 10:30, 11 o'clock.
Did you know that you weren't entitled to work on a tourist visa?
No, I had no idea. No, I didn't know.
What were you paid for that 3 years of work?
Nothing. I had no pay, no money.
At all?
They didn't pay me at all, no. Sometimes I ask them for the money, but she starts getting angry on me and she starts to say bad words towards me, so, no.
Did you know anyone here?
No, I didn't know anyone here.
Did you complain to anyone?
No, I didn't speak to anyone. I never spoke to the neighbours because they were always keeping an eye on me, whom I'm talking to, and they told everyone that I couldn't speak English.
Did you not think about complaining or, you know, trying to find someone to help you?
Well, I didn't know that someone would help me if I need help. I thought it's like my country. If women go out, need for help, you are very low in the society. No one will help you.
Were you able to speak to your family in Fiji?
No. They had the phone, but they got the PIN number on the phone, landline, and I couldn't ring anyone.
Why did you stay for 3 years?
I had no idea, like, where to go, who will give me help. I had no passport, I had no money, I didn't know anyone.
How did the family treat you?
They would threaten me, they would swear at me, and they were like...
When you say threaten you, what do you mean?
Whenever I ask them for the money or I ask them for my passport, they always tell me, oh, we brought you here, we paid for your plane ticket, we paid for your visa, you have to stay with us and work and wait for your permanent residence.
How did you get out of this situation?
One of the ladies, she was her friend. She used to come and visit the house maybe 2 or 3 times a week. So I had a chance to talk to her one day. So she knew something was wrong. I told her, she saw me crying always in the house. So I said to her, maybe if you have any chance to help me, I told her, just call immigration. Maybe they'll take me away from this house or maybe they'll deport me to my country.
So what happened when the Department of Immigration came?
So she tried to hide me in a tool room.
She tried to hide you in the tool room?
She told me to go into the tool shed and she wanted to put the padlock. But when I heard the immigration, I was so happy and I thought, no, I'm not going in there. So I stayed, I didn't go. Because I knew, I heard, lucky she told me immigration is there. So I was feeling happy inside. They will definitely do something. Either they will take me or whatever.
And what happened? Where did you go?
They brought me to the city. And from that time, I came to know Salvation Army, safe house. So I straight away went to the safe house.
Did you get any money from the family in the end?
At the end, I got some money from them. That was not compensation and not my wages. That was only the settlement.
And now, what are you doing now?
I'm an aged care nurse now.
And your status, are you an Australian citizen?
I am an Australian citizen, so things have been moved.
Sandra, thanks very much for talking to us.
Thank you.
Laura, you ran the Salvation Army safe house that Sandra ended up Ash, what did you think when you first heard her story?
Sandra's story wasn't unique. We experience many domestic workers in private homes who have experienced exploitation quite similar to Sandra's situation. Hers was unique in the sense of how long she was there.
Well, this was 2006 to 2009 this happened, yeah?
Yeah, we met her in 2009, where she stayed with us for 2 years. More than 50% of the people that we support have experienced exploitation and slavery as domestic workers.
Was anyone prosecuted in that case?
No one was prosecuted in the case because prior to 2013, there was not a forced labour offence that could apply to the situation. That has changed. So in 2013, a criminal offence for forced labour was introduced. But at the time in which Sandra experienced her situation, there was not any legal protections available to her.
Jennifer, you're a lawyer. You specialise in slavery and human trafficking. Just listening to all of this tonight, why aren't more people made accountable for these sorts of things happening in Australia?
That's a good question. I think we've heard a whole spectrum of stories and narrative tonight telling us about different forms of exploitation in the workplace, and they're very concerning. But thinking about Sandra's case for a moment, I think there's an extra point there that I think that she was exploited in that private home in about 2006. I think that was the year.
Between 2006 and 2009.
Yeah. So there's a really interesting report that I read about an AFP, Australian Federal Police, investigation that covered 2006. And that report really highlights the complexity of the investigative process. So in the case that I'm thinking about, the report said that for this particular investigation into trafficking, Australian Federal Police spent 3,000 hours investigating, and that investigative process included the need to listen to over 27,000 telephone intercepts, many of which were in a foreign language. And that's a case into trafficking, but where there was a lot of evidence that could be brought to bear to establish the elements of the offences. So we do have offences of slavery. We know what slavery is in Australia, and we do have offences of trafficking and forced labour. But often the challenge there is to bring enough evidence that would prove to a court beyond reasonable doubt that a person is guilty of those kinds of offences.
What are the areas where you see the most problems?
We know that there are serious issues in the hospitality industry, in private homes, in agriculture.
The Global Slavery Index has just come out with a report estimating 4,300 people could be enslaved in Australia right now.
When I was younger, I loved boxing. Before I came here, this one guy that promised me, gave me a good opportunity in life. And he promised me a lot of good things, so I bought into it. When I came here, it turns to nothing at all. When I live in the city, when I was living with them, they treat us like we're, you know, lower class person kind of thing, you know? Like a slave kind of thing. A slave is better than us, I think, because they make money on us and they let us work in their house as well. Here in Melbourne, yeah, a lot better than when I was in Sydney.
Caesar, life looks pretty good there. Where are you living?
I live with my manager at the moment.
Mm-hmm. You're preparing for a big fight in August.
Yeah.
But you were originally brought to Australia by a boxing promoter in Sydney in 2013. Tell us a bit more about what it was like living with him.
He promised me that when I came here, he gave me a job and a fight as well.
And did any of those things happen?
Nothing.
And where were you living?
I just live in the garage.
In his garage?
Yeah, in his garage.
By yourself?
No, four of us.
Four of us
living,
you?
Yeah.
Other boxes?
Yeah. Yeah, four of us, and they treat us like a houseboy as well.
What did you have to do?
We need to clean the house, look after the kids, and it's like washing dishes and things like that.
Did he pay you for that at
all? No, nothing.
So what did you eat?
Yeah, we just ate leftover foods and things like that, yeah.
He took your passport.
Yeah, yeah.
How long did he take your passport for?
He took my passport about two months until we got an argument and he kicked me out in his house.
So you reported it to the police?
Yeah, reported, yeah.
And what happened?
And yeah, the police helped us and the government helped us as well. So yeah.
The government helped you as well?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You were granted a protection visa to stay in Australia, yeah. And the AFP brought charges, criminal charges against that man, but the Commonwealth Department of Public Prosecutions dropped those charges in August last year.
Yeah.
How do you feel about that?
Yeah, I feel a bit sad about it. I feel so sad about it. Yeah, of all the things that, you know, of all the bad things that we go through and doesn't be a success. But yeah, we still feel good because the Australian gave us a visa that we can live here, and yeah, gave us a chance to live life here too.
Mm. Jennifer, why do you think these cases stumble when they're investigated and prosecuted?
I think cases like these highlight some of the difficulties in the legislative scheme. And at the time of this particular story, as we've heard tonight, we did not have forced labour offences in Australian law. And I think that those offences will transform this area of law on a national level. The trafficking offences are complicated. They require evidence to be produced across borders, they're transnational investigations, and they require an intense resourcing.
So how long have the new laws been in effect?
They came into effect in March 2013.
Have there been any prosecutions under those new laws?
I saw a report that said that there have been some charges laid and there are cases before the courts, but so far there have been no hearings.
How more broadly do we deal with some of these issues when they're so invisible? You know, if somebody's... I mean, I'm interested in what the Salvation Army thinks about this, you know. If someone's seeing a situation that they think just doesn't look right, who do you go to?
We need to be careful, though, because I think someone with, you know, the best of intentions can actually put someone at greater risk. So step one is to know what the indicators are. We liken this field to what domestic was like, awareness of domestic violence 10, 20 years ago. We've made such terrific advancements in that field. We need to get this... I mean, it's very common for us to talk to people and people think, oh, you mean overseas, right? And this is happening here. The Global Slavery Index has just come out with a report estimating 4,300 people could be enslaved in Australia right now. So we need to accept that we have a problem here. We need to educate the public about what the signs are and give people contacts. We've recommended a national hotline. AFP has a specialist human trafficking unit, but it's very small with limited capacity and couldn't manage, you know, once public awareness really gets up there, full referrals from across the country.
Who do you go to? I mean, anyone like to give an answer to that?
We think that there's a need for an anti-slavery commissioner in Australia, somebody who is independent, who can coordinate a whole range of government and non-government initiatives and strategies to make sure that we are looking at this properly. And then the other thing is that there is a clear lack in avenues to path for compensation for people who have been trafficked or enslaved. And across Australia, there are different schemes that are inconsistent, and we think that there should be a national scheme.
I think a lot of the issue as well is the fact that culturally, if people don't come from places where they have a justice system that they can fairly, you know, go to and approach for compensation in cases like that, combined with the fact that they're arriving in a country where they don't realise these rights exist, then there needs to be some sort of framework for them to connect with services, I think, is the big point.
And we all know, of course, the reason why so many international students are here, and I say this as a former international student, you know, with the diminished funding of universities, increasing reliance on international student income, they come here, they need to meet the living costs and the student fees, they work in these poor, exploitative jobs.
And then they get caught in a cycle. So what has happened to a lot of our clients is they because they're getting paid half the pay, they work outside of their visa hours. When they finally realise that they should be getting more pay and they go to the employer and say, my pay's wrong, the employer says, if you tell anyone about this, I'll report the fact that you've worked outside your visa hours and you'll get deported. And they end up getting stuck in this vicious cycle of underpayment with the threat of deportation looming over them.
Jesse, I think there's some modelling when it comes to workplace law in other countries, and the US is an example when it comes to exploitation of migrant workers there. You know, they've got joint employment law in the US, so it's quite funny that the most deregulated OECD country in the world, and one of the richest, has joint employment law, which generally binds wage rates and protections from the employee being engaged by a labour agent to the principal company. And we haven't got that here. And it's something that we've been calling for a very long time. I think, and the other countries are Canada and also Sweden have joint employment law.
Pranay, your experience of being underpaid by a 7-Eleven franchisee was well publicised by Four Corners and Fairfax. Why did you go to the media with your story?
Actually, I had no option. First thing, I had a work injury. So I had to leave the job. Then I looked into the website about the pay rates and everything.
Giri, you're Pranay's lawyer sitting beside you. You helped him to get a $33,000 settlement for underpaid wages from 7-Eleven. Is that easier to achieve after media attention?
If there wasn't media attention, nothing would have been achieved. And the important point to note is it didn't come from the franchisee, it came from the franchisor. That's the only reason we've been able to launch this pro bono scheme, to help a whole number of people, because after the public shaming on Four Corners and the publicity, the franchisor wasn't able to simply turn a blind eye to this systematic wage fraud that was taking place across all of the franchisees. So it's only because of the involvement of the franchisor and the attention that we were able to assist not just Pranay, we've got over 100 clients who were helping through this underpayment panel that they've set up.
What was it like going through that, Pranay? The media attention?
I was feeling bad for this.
Why?
Because I have to put my studies back. I'm back with my academics. And I have to come through this way, which I don't have any job now, to be honest. No one's hiring me. So maybe I'll get deported in two months or 3 months. I don't know. I don't have a visa. So there's no use of coming forward.
There's all this focus on your rights or obligations under a visa in terms of the awareness that's been spoken about. But with all of the clients we've spoken to, and it's literally over 100, no one gets any education about your actual workplace rights. You get told, oh, these are your visa conditions, and I think this is the same point that you made earlier. But, and you enter the country, you get told, don't bring any animals or plants, but you're not actually getting told what your rights are.
What your entitlements are.
At work.
It's a really important point.
Selena, you later found work as an au pair with two other families. Yes. What was that work like?
So I stayed then with another family straight after. They paid me a really good price for it. Like, I got good money. I had a car, I had petrol. When I wanted off, like, on a Saturday, I got off. Like, they were really kind to me. They appreciated my work. So now I'm always a part of the family.
So what do you think of Australia after your experience?
I love it now. I don't want to leave anymore.
Sana, what do you think of Australia after your experience?
Well, I'm still looking for a job and still in the same condition. But one thing that is making me stay here is the law. I think the Australian law, they have a very strong law for everything. The only problem with that is that the application, the way of application. So there should be some regulatory reforms that inspectors or health inspectors, they should visit regularly the sites and determine those problems.
Sunny, what do you think, given your experience?
I think there should be more support to the workers on knowing their rights.
Pranay, what do you think about Australia after your experience?
When I came here, I went to college. They said everything about the Australia, about the culture, about the people. But they didn't tell me about the work rights.
So you'd like to be told what your rights are?
Yeah.
Amy, what do you think about Australia after your experience?
I still believe people here is lovely. And if I know union first, I will join the union first. And union will protect us.
Caesar, what do you think about Australia?
Australia gives me another chance of life. And yeah, I was just very lucky that I knew this person that helped me as well, my manager Brian and Matruda, and my trainer as well. They treat me like their own family. And yeah, I was just lucky that I know them. And Australia gives me a visa that I can live here too, and I can do what I want. And I'm free to do the things that I want to do.
All right, we'll have to leave it there. Thank you all very much for joining us tonight and sharing your stories. And that is all we have time for here. But let's keep talking on Twitter and on Facebook. When he died, he left you nothing. Correct. Why?
His behaviour was very unlikable.
Deirdre, when your mother died, you and your sister ended up in the Supreme Court of Victoria. Why?
The law is stupid.
I'm going to talk for the dead people here because, you know, that's kind of my role. There are kids who've been horrible to their parents. Doesn't matter?
The court will no longer just allow people to say, I think they treated me badly.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everyone.